The God of hope give you all joy and peace in believing in his Son, so that by the power of the Spirit you may abound in hope. Some of you have lasted, even if I'm making hard work of it. The topic this morning is the family altar, the discipline of table devotions, family devotions, whatever you like to call them, for daily sanctification. Has the fire gone out? I'm a great believer in natural church growth. That's not right, strictly speaking, because all church growth is supernatural. The Lord always gives the increase. But in our concern for the mission of the church, I think we have sometimes missed the obvious. The church has always grown. The faith has always been passed on, most obviously, within the family. From parents to children, and children to grandchildren. That's the way the church grows, fundamentally, basically. There's other ways it grows beyond that and connected with that, but the church never grows, I believe, apart from that. Has the fire gone out? I look at my own family. It's hard to see this on the large scale, but you can see this on the small scale. Just imagine if in every generation all children born to believers remained within the church. My family, okay? There's two of us, myself and Claire. That's where it starts. We have four children, apart from the in-laws and the connections to other families through those in-laws. And we have nine grandchildren. Do you see? There's a doubling there in each generation. If only we, those people from Christian families, remain Christians and practice the faith, the church would double. At least if the rate of reproduction that we have is common, you have children every generation. Or go back a little bit further and the figures are more astonishing. My parents had eight children and they have 25 grandchildren. Do the maths for yourself. And go back further and it's even more astonishing because there were nine children in my father's side and there were 11 children in my mother's side of the family. I've lost track of how many cousins I've got. Has the fire gone out? And is that one of the big issues? Was that one of the big problems? The unacknowledged problem in Australia and in America, the Lutheran Church. There was an ancient custom, a custom in the ancient world that head of the house, the woman, the mother, the housewife, would make sure that the fire on the hearth would never go out. You know, they couldn't switch on a switch and you get an electric stove or a gas stove. They didn't have matches. It was pretty hard to start fire. So you kept the home fire burning. You'd stoke it in the morning from the coals that had been covered with ashes, you'd keep it going all day, and then you'd cover the coals at the evening, and so the fire would go from day to day, and the aim of the housewife was to make sure that the fire on the hearth never went out. I don't know whether you realize the same thing happened at the temple in Jerusalem. God's glory came from the Holy of Holies and lit the fire on the altar. And it was the duty of the priests, one of their fundamental duties, to make sure that that fire never went out. It was the daily fire, the perpetual fire, the fire that never went out. It never went out until the temple was destroyed. And so it had to be rekindled when the temple was rededicated. There was the altar fire that never went out. Now, within the Jewish tradition, and even more so in the Christian tradition, that is a picture of family devotion. Just as there is was the temple altar, there is the family altar. Just as there's the church altar, there is the home altar. And they are the two pillars of the faith, practically speaking. I would maintain that you can't hold, just as you can't one pillar can't hold up a roof, both of the pillars need to be there for the church to be healthy. But if I look at what's happened within my own lifetime in Australia, something rather has happened that saddens me immensely. I don't know if the same thing has happened here in North America. I grew up in a tradition which goes back generations of family devotions. Devotions, morning and evening. Morning, mum and dad did it. If we kids were up, we joined with them, but there was no big deal. But in the evening, everybody who was at home joined in family devotions in and around the evening meal. Now, that's the way I received the faith. I am what I am as a Christian, because of the faith that was passed on to me in this simple way by my father and my mother. And they received it from their parents, and they received it from their parents, going back to as far as I can trace, both sides of the family. But the sad thing is that the tradition of the family altar, family devotions, has disappeared from the Lutheran Church of Australia, even amongst church-going families, and most sadly of all, even amongst the families of pastors. And then we wonder why we have spiritual problems. Our challenge, I believe, one of the great challenges that faces us, is to rekindle that fire. That fire, which Paul says in Romans 12, verse 12, and he's speaking about he's referring to the temple altar. He says, "Be ablaze with the Spirit." You know how that passage was used a little while ago in your synod. The problem is that you look at one end of it, but not the other end of it. Okay, be ablaze with the Spirit, which means keep the fire burning in every congregation, in every home, and in the heart of every single Christian. Now, before we get too pessimistic and too discouraged, let me tell you that the situation at the time of Luther was far worse than it is today. I won't map it out, but Luther, instead of cursing the darkness and tut-tutting and disapproving of what was happening, did something very simple about it. Very simple, very realistic. And the result of his antidote, his way of dealing with this problem, is parts 7 and 8 of the Catechism. Morning and evening prayers, grace before and after meals. So simple, and yet so profound, and with such far-reaching consequences. In the kingdom of heaven, little is big, and big is little. The little leaven leavens the lump. The little mustard seed produces a huge plant. And one of the problems of us Westerners, we are too little, we think too little because we think too big. We always think statistically. We want big results, and so we neglect to do the little things, which are the big things. And one of the little things is family devotions, grace before and after meals. Now, the tradition of these practices, I'll lump them together and say just family devotions, goes right back to the Old Testament and is built on the Old Testament. God instituted the divine service, first at the tabernacle and at the temple, but at the same time as he instituted the divine service, he instituted family devotions for each Jewish household. Each Jewish household was to say the Shema. Just listen to it. Before I go there, I want to give you a bit of a background to this. Over the last 10, 20 years, I've travelled extensively, and one of the parts of the world that fascinates me most of all is Asia. I've had deep connections with the Indian Lutheran Church, the Tamil Indian Lutheran Church in Malaysia, and then also visited India. And everywhere you go there, but it's obvious in India, but in Malaysia, where you have Hindu people, you find idols everywhere. There's shrines everywhere, down every street. The same with Thailand, with Buddhist people. There's shrines with altars. There's idols almost on every street. You have idols in every house, and you have altars all over the place. Every house has its idol and its altar. And even more than that, most Hindus and most Buddhists wear amulets around their neck, ears, belly button, and also other places, less even some unmentionable places. They wear and they have tattoos. They wear little idols, symbols of their gods, the god that they have devoted to, or in Buddha's case, some representation of Buddha. Now, why is it that pagan people set up idols and altars in each house? Why is it that they wear idols, if I can use that term, on their bodies and on the sensitive parts of their bodies? Ears, to do with hearing, eyes, seeing, mouth, nose, genitals, feet, hands. Well, the purpose of these idols is to ensure good luck and to ward off bad luck. That's the belief. The idol is the means by which the god or goddess is present. And it's the means by which you access blessing and protection from the god that you're devoted to. Now, that's not just the custom of Hindus and Buddhists to the present day. That was the custom of almost all people in the ancient world. Everybody would wear religious jewelry. You'd have shrines in every household. Now, God, when he called his people Israel, replaced the idol with something far better. And he replaced the devotion that the people gave to their idols with a far better and a far more powerful form of devotion. This is what he commanded for his people Israel. I give my own translation to accentuate a number of points. It's a single sentence. God says, Hear, O Israel, the Lord, that's the holy name Yahweh, is our God. And the Lord, Yahweh, is one. Notice the naming of the holy name here. Yahweh, our God, Yahweh, is one. So that you may love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, that's with all your breath, your throat, your appetite, and with all your strength, and that these words which I command to you today may be in your heart, and that you may recite them to your children, that you may speak them when you sit down in your home, when you walk on the way, when you lie down, and when you get up. and that you may bind them as a sign on your hand, and that you may that they may be frontlets between your eyes, and that they and that you may write them on the door frames of your houses and your gates. You have Israel's basic confession of faith. And there's two instructions that God gives to Israel. They are to hear, and if they hear, they will love. Hear, love. Hear, love. That's the basic rhythm of the life of God's people. So this has to do with daily devotions in every Jewish household, everywhere, at all times and in all places. This devotion is to be twice a day at the turning points, from the turning point from night to day and from day to night, in the morning and in the evening. And it was not initially, not the time of Moses, but when Solomon instituted, established the temple choir and the singing of psalms in the morning service and in the evening service, this daily devotion then was synchronized with the morning and evening sacrifice in the temple. And it was an extension of the daily service from the temple into the home. And by means of this daily devotion, the Israelites at home continued to participate in the temple service, even though they may have been hundreds of miles away from the temple. Now, just look at this, the nature of this simple act of devotion. It's so simple, and yet I put it to you that it's immensely profound and effective and productive. The center of this act of devotion is the daily confession of faith. Israel's basic daily confession of faith is very simple. It's saying that the Lord is their God. Hear, O Israel. Now you get their confession of faith. This is to the present day. Every Jew says this. This is the Jewish confession of faith. Yahweh, the Lord, is our God, and Yahweh is one. There's no other God beside him. Simple confession of faith. So the focus is on the confession of faith and naming God. Lord, what we translate as Lord, is not a title, but it's a proper name. It's the holy name of God. No, I should say the most holy name of God. It's the most holy of all holy things. The holy name of God. Second commandment. As part of the daily devotion, you get the call every day from God to his people to listen to the confession of faith, so that they will love the Lord their God in three ways. They'll only be able to love the Lord if they keep on listening to God. Listen to God, and then loving God. And they're to love God in three ways, with their whole heart, by memorizing these words, by taking the name of God and speaking the name of God into their hearts, so that their hearts become temples of the living God. So they're to love God with their hearts. Notice the progression here. With their whole soul. Soul for English is a bit waffly. In Hebrew it's quite straightforward. Soul is breath, and therefore it has to do with speaking and breathing. Loving God with the heart, with the soul, that's speaking, and speaking out aloud and together with their children, and with their whole strength, that's their physical strength, by placing the name of God in their hearts and then on their bodies and in their places of residence. So did you notice where the name of God was to be placed? By speaking it, first of all, and reciting it, you place it in your heart. You place it in your family with your children. You recite it. And then you put it on the door frames of the houses where you normally put the name of the owner of the house. There God's name is placed. And you put it at the gates of the village. It goes even further than that. Now, what's instituted by God is the recitation of these words. There's no prescribed prayer given. You can improvise that. But you're given the framework for prayer. Okay? Notice that it focuses around a confession of faith. Now, in Numbers chapter 15, 37 to 40, God adds something to this to make it even more physical and more practical and to show the significance of this daily act of devotion. What does this daily act of devotion do? What is it meant to accomplish every morning, every evening, for the whole life of Israel, sleeping and working? You know, the daily cycle, sleeping, working, home, business. This is what God says to Moses. The Lord said to Moses, speak to the people of Israel and tell them to make tassels, their little dangles, on the corners of their garments throughout their generations, and to put a cord of blue on the tassels of each corner. So white shawl, tassels, and then blue little cords at the end of the tassels. And it shall be a tassel for you to look at and to remember all the commandments of the Lord to do them. So you shall remember and do all my commandments and be a holy thing, a holy person, or best of all, a holy shrine to the Lord. A holy place to God. So the picture is, by doing this, your body becomes holy. And your body becomes a walking, talking, living shrine of the living God, taking the living God wherever you go. God in you. God with you. Now, the book of Deuteronomy makes it quite clear that the purpose of this daily confession of faith is to receive the blessing of God each morning and each evening. The purpose is for the reception of the blessing that God wants to give to his people in his land. It substitutes for the name on the that's used in the confession of faith replaces the idol. Just as the idol was is the means of access that pagan people have to their gods, so God puts his name in the temple instead of an idol. He gives his name to his people. Through that name, they access God's grace. They access the presence of God. The name replaces the idol as the focus of daily devotion. And God's, did you get the surprise there? So God's location is not in the idol, but where's God's location? In the village, in the home, in the family, and in the heart. In the heart is the place where God dwells. And notice this very strong emphasis that God gives to Moses and his people is that they are to recite this confession of faith with their children and to get their children to join with them in this daily act of devotion, this daily confession of faith, the daily calling on the name of the Lord. And they're to use it in the morning when they get up. They're to conduct this act of devotion in the morning when they get up, before they go to work, and in the evening before they lie down and go to sleep. So this governs both their working and their rest, their whole day, both sides of it. And moreover, they're not only to speak the words of this basic confession of faith, but they are to write it on their hands. Why their hands? So that their hands are blessed and made holy. They're to write it on their foreheads. The forehead covers the whole body, so the whole body is blessed and made holy. And more remarkably, they are to put it on the doors of their houses, which means the whole house is a blessed house, a protected house, a holy house, a little shrine, a little temple. Even better than that, they are to put it on the gates of their villages. What does that do to the whole village? It makes it a blessed place, a holy place, a place where God is graciously present with his people. So God puts his name on them. He takes over possession of them. His presence is with them through his holy name. And as a result of that, his people not only receive his blessing, but they are bearers of blessing. They take his blessing from God out into their daily lives. Notice the progression of the name. The name is spoken with the mouth. It comes into the ears, and from the ears into the heart. And from the heart, it reaches out through the whole of the body. And from the body, it reaches out through the whole of the family, the house. And from the house, it goes to the village. And the implication is then, and through work, it's taken out into the fields. So the name goes in and the name goes out with all the implications of that. Now, what's the purpose of this shawl that they are to put on? You know that Jews, when they pray, have a little box on their hand with the Shema written on, and they have it on the forehead. Every Jewish household has a mezuzah, which contains these words, the front door. If you have any Jewish friend, just look for it. It'll be there somewhere. Okay? Now, what's the purpose of the shawl that they are to wear? It's a white shawl with tassels and then blue little strips at the end. Well, it is to bring home to the Israelites that they participate in God's holiness. That because the name of God is on them and the name of God is in them, God, the Holy God, is present in them, and his presence sanctifies them. And their bodies, not just their hearts, but their whole bodies, are temples, are shrines of the living God. And they use this prayer shawl to remind them of their priestly status. White and blue are the basic color of the priestly vestments. White, purity; blue, the color of heaven. So they are holy people, heavenly people, living heavenly priestly lives here on earth. And they are to remember the Lord as they do their act of devotion every morning and evening by enacting his sanctifying commands. And the most important sanctifying commandment, the word, is to hear and to love. Hear, love. They are the fundamental imperatives of their life. They are sanctified, they are made holy, they remain holy by hearing the holy name and by speaking the holy name. And the result of their sanctification, by speaking the holy name, hearing the holy name, bringing the holy name into their hearts, into their families, taking it out into their village and daily life, is that they will love God with all their heart, with all their soul, and with all their strength. That's one Jewish custom. Now, I've taken some time in doing this because Luther, in his large catechism, quite clearly bases his whole catechism, as well as morning and evening prayer, not on any text in the New Testament, but on this text in the Old Testament. If you were listening very carefully to that extract from the large catechism, we didn't read far enough there, but Luther very clearly refers to this passage in Deuteronomy as the foundation for one of the foundations for the catechism. The second Jewish custom was to say a blessing before and after a meal. And we heard this read, was it yesterday, I think, Deuteronomy 8, verse 10. When you eat, That's the beginning of the meal. And when you're satisfied, that's at the end of the meal, you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land that he's given you. Now, when God blesses us, he gives us his blessing. When we bless God, we acknowledge God as the giver of blessing. So the Israelites bless God at the beginning and end of every meal because he is the giver of not just of food, but through food, his blessing to his people. So they have blessings before the meal, they have blessings after the meal. And the picture here is of God as the host and the Israelites as his guests. So at the beginning of the meal, you acknowledge God's the host and you thank the host for the meal. And at the end of the meal, you acknowledge that God's the host and that he's given you the meal. To bless God is to acknowledge that he is the giver of this food and the blessing that comes through this food. By the time of the New Testament, the Pharisees had built upon this very deep ancient foundation, which was very, very strong at the time of Jesus, and they'd added to it because they believed that since the name of God, which was located at the temple, was invoked at every meal, this made every meal a holy meal and an extension of the holy banquets that they had at the temple in Jerusalem. And you won't understand a lot of the fuss the Pharisees make about washing hands and avoiding unclean people unless you see that that was at the center of their piety. The whole of the piety of Pharisees focused around meals and the family altar. And fundamentally, Jesus didn't disagree with them on that score. His point of disagreement was elsewhere. Now, the New Testament just continues and assumes that the practice of saying grace before and after meals will continue. Let's just let me just go through the data very quickly. Particularly, Luke emphasizes that Jesus, before after every meal, would say blessing. He would bless the bread. He'd bless God at the end of the meal as the giver of the food. Paul mentions it in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, quite incidentally, as if it was self-evident. He didn't have to explain it. Everybody knew about it. He says, "The earth is the Lord's and everything in it." Now, he quotes here from Psalm 24, verse 1, which was commonly used as one form of grace in the Jewish community, and then in the Christian community as a result of it. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. And then he goes on to say, excuse me, if I take part in a meal with meat, with thanks or grace, why am I denounced for what I say thanksgiving? So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. So he says, there were some people who said that Christians should be vegetarians. I won't go into why. There's good theological reasons that they had for it. At least they believed so. So not eating meat. But Paul says, God created everything. Everything is good. And therefore, it's given for our enjoyment. And if we say thanksgiving at the beginning of the meal, why should people object to the fact that I eat meat? And he says, whether you eat meat or not, whether you drink water or alcohol, and whatever you do in a meal, you do it all for the glory of God when you give thanks to God for the food and drink that he gives. So he refers here to the practice of saying thanks for food as a gift from God for our enjoyment. And more than that, because when he goes to and whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God, refers, you do doxology in the presence of God, not and you praise God not just for what his gifts, but the fact that he is present with you. So you don't just say thanks to God for the meal, but you also acknowledge that God has been present there as the host of that meal, and you give him glory, you acknowledge that he is the head of the house, he is the host in the meal. Now, Paul gives the theological rationale for saying grace before and after meals, as well as a very simple basic instruction in his first letter to Timothy, chapter 4, 3 and 4. And the context here is that there's many Christians in the congregation in Ephesus who believed that they needed to be vegetarians or avoid certain kinds of food, or that to be a spirit-filled Christian, a Christian filled with the Holy Spirit, you had to avoid sex altogether. So that meat, alcohol, sex basically prevented you from being a fully spiritual Christian. This is what he says. God created food to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. For everything created by God is good, and nothing is to be rejected if it is received with thanksgiving. For it is made holy by the word of God and prayer. Now just take hold of that. This is one of the key texts in Lutheran theology. There's much of the liturgical theology of Luther and the piety of Luther that you won't understand unless you begin with this text. Everything is made holy, how? By the word of God and prayer. Paul says to the Christians in Ephesus that all food is good, and because it's good, it needs to be received with thanksgiving. And he assumes that every Christian home will say thanks to God in saying grace before the meal. And more than that, you don't only acknowledge that God is the host and the giver of the meal, but because the name of God is invoked and the word of God is used, then the food is made holy, the people are made holy, and the house is made holy. Did you hear that? By the saying of grace before and after meals, the food is made holy, the family is made holy, and the house becomes a holy place. So we say grace to acknowledge that God blesses us through this, as he blesses all human beings. But better than that, by saying grace, the meal, the people, and the place are made holy. So the food ceases to be common, ordinary food and becomes holy food, given by God to his holy priestly people to do holy work together with a holy God. Now that's a dimension that we need to recapture amongst our people. So why is it that I say grace before and after meals? So that the food is made holy, like the food at the temple in Jerusalem, because I'm doing my priestly service. In everything, I'm a part of God's royal priesthood, and everything I do as a member of his holy priesthood, I do holy work with the holy God, bringing the blessings of the holy God to the world and the people that I associate with. And you have here the basic pattern of Christian devotion. If everything is sanctified by the word of God and prayer, so daily devotions will focus on which things? The word and prayer. The holy word and prayer, which invokes the holy name of God. Just a little aside here. I don't think we take seriously enough the last part of the lesson that was read to us from 1 Peter. Did you hear it this morning? Right at the end, Peter speaks about the imperishable seed. The imperishable seed, which is the word, which remains forever. If the word is imperishable, if you teach it, put it in the hearts of people, it may not have effect on them immediately. They may reject it, but the word, they cannot kill the word. The word remains imperishable and stays there, and it will bear fruit at its the right time. The imperishable word, if you speak the imperishable word of the gospel into the hearts of people, nothing can destroy it. It remains alive, and therefore it can, in the right time and right season, make that person spiritually alive. So you have the pattern, the word of God and prayer. You see it in our basic graces. You have a piece of scripture and you have a prayer together. How's time going? Yes, I think I can get this in. Now, as well as that, Luther says, so you have grace before and after meals. I think we need to teach it. It's simple, it's profound. It's not only that we get people to do it, but we need to teach and preach the value of it, the benefits that come from doing it, which are profound. Okay, as well as that, Luther says that there should be morning and evening prayer for the family. Now, he doesn't use the word for morning and evening prayer the way you have it in the translation in your hymn book and catechism, but he actually calls it the morning and evening blessing. The morning and evening blessing. Now, what's the context for the enactment? This is the catechism part 7. Grace is catechism part 8. Okay, what's the context for morning and evening blessings? Okay, the location is the home with the extended family. Times for morning and evening blessing: at the beginning of the day, evening before going to bed, and it's the responsibility of the head of the household, the head of the family, whether it is a man or a woman, for teaching the whole household. The head of the family is the priest of the family, so he's responsible for the family altar. Can I say that again? Most of you are heads of families. You are the priests in the family. And not just for you and your wife, but also for your children and grandchildren, the extended family. It's performed by individuals. You know, if people live by themselves, they do it. If it's just husband and wife, they do it together. Or if you have a nuclear family, you do it that way. If you have extended family, you do it that way. It's immensely adaptable. Anyway. And notice, too, that Luther emphasizes the importance of posture and gesture. We do it kneeling or standing, making the sign of the cross, these kinds of things. We pray, not just with our hearts or minds or voices, but we pray with our bodies as well. Let me take you through the morning and evening blessing in Luther's catechism, number 7. Please, you dear pastor, dear brothers, make sure that when you teach confirmation, you don't neglect to teach this. Teach this. Part 7 is basically praying the catechism. The catechism is not given basically as a textbook for dogmatics, but it's a handbook for daily devotion. It's quite clear. Did you hear that reading this morning? The catechism is the handbook of daily devotion. How do you use the catechism in daily devotion? You see most clearly here now. Luther was very realistic, and the sociological conditions in his day were almost as difficult as in our day. People had very little time. It was hard to get families together. You had to have something that was simple. If it was too long, kids would be bored. It would be hard to sustain. You had to have it at a time when you could get everybody together. So he locates morning and evening prayer together with morning and evening meal. So that's easier to sustain. Well, what does the morning blessing and evening blessing consist of? First of all, you have the invocation with the sign of the cross. And Luther says, you bless yourself by saying, In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay, you put the sign of the cross on you. And by putting the sign of your cross on you, it says, my mother taught me Jesus came from heaven to earth to come into my heart. Lovely practice. The German makes it quite clear that it's an act of blessing. It's God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, watch over me, or grant this to me, or grant me blessing. It's self-blessing. And by saying, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you reenact or claim, you reclaim both your baptism and the divine service. So you make clear that this act of devotion comes out of baptism. It's the result of baptism. It's because you're a baptized child of God and because you are a member of His holy church. And the family devotion is an extension of the liturgy and prepares you to participate more fully in the liturgy. They go together. Thirdly, you do it in the morning before you go to work and in the evening before you go to sleep, so that both your work and your sleep is done in the name of the triune God, which means that you don't work by yourself and for yourself, but you work with God and you sleep with God. Your whole life is caught up in the service of God. The Jews placed frontlets with the confession of faith on their foreheads, so to place the name of God over them and on them. Well, we don't place a little bit of cloth with some words on it, but we place the sign of the cross on us to show that we've been redeemed by Christ and His name is on us and in us. We've been redeemed by Christ, therefore we are saved, and we are holy people who belong to Him. Instead of dressing ourselves with a prayer shawl, we dress ourselves with the holiness and righteousness of Christ by reclaiming or remembering our baptism. We go back to our baptism, say, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So first of all, you have the invocation. Very simple and yet profound in what it does. The second thing is the saying of the Apostles' Creed. Remember, the Jews say their creed, we say our creed. And our daily devotions center around the Apostles' Creed, which is the baptismal creed. And by saying that creed, we reaffirm our baptism. We confess our faith in one God, and we declare our allegiance and commitment to Him every morning, every evening. But instead of the focus of our devotion being on the law and the keeping of the law, which we do, but that's not the focus of our daily devotion. The focus of our daily devotion is on the gospel, which is summarized by the Apostles' Creed. We focus on hearing the good news of salvation that comes to us from the triune God. So the Christian life is a life of faith in the gospel. And not only do we confess our faith at the beginning and the end of every day, but by doing that, our whole life is an enacted, lived out confession of our faith, our commitment, our allegiance to the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Our whole day is an exercise in hearing the gospel and in loving God. That's the dynamic of our Christian lives. Thirdly, Luther urges us to pray the Lord's Prayer, and that's very significant. Now, there's one aspect of the Lord's Prayer that we have forgotten. Luther teaches it, theologians in the Middle Ages teach it, the early church teaches it. And that's this, that the Lord's Prayer is the prayer of Jesus. Jesus prays the Lord's Prayer. He's the only one who can address God as Father. But because of His incarnation and our baptism, We are united with him, he is united with us, and we are sons and daughters of God together with Jesus. And that means that everything that Jesus is and has belongs to us, and everything that belongs to us belongs to Jesus. And so when we pray the Lord's Prayer, we don't just pray the prayer that Jesus has taught us, but we pray together with Jesus. Can I emphasize that? He does the praying and we join in the prayer. In the same way as you parents say the Lord's Prayer and gradually your children join in with you. First of all, bits and pieces, and then more and more. You pray for them, they pray together with you. It's the same way that Jesus prays for us. So when we pray the Lord's Prayer, it's the best prayer because it's the prayer of Jesus. If you want to know what Jesus as the intercessor prays before God the Father, day and night and always, this is the summary of his prayer for us and the whole world. And in the Lord's Prayer, our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name, forgive us this day our daily bread. Forgive us. Who's the us? It's not just my family, my congregation, church, but it's all people on earth. We pray on behalf of all people on earth. So this is the prayer that embraces the world. And by means of that prayer, we intercede on behalf of the whole world. We have access to God's presence and heavenly blessings, and we pray for God's heavenly blessings for ourselves and people on earth. Most of all, the Lord's Prayer is our exercise in loving God by loving our neighbour. How do you most clearly love as a Christian, as a holy person, love your wife, love your children, love your neighbour, love your enemy? By praying for them. In time, enact our love, Christian love, priestly love, by praying for people. So hearing the baptismal confession of faith as baptized people, loving by praying. Now, the morning and evening prayer, Luther includes. So there's morning and evening prayer, invocation, creed, Lord's Prayer, both morning and evening. But morning and evening prayer, you have a different little free prayer. You know it well. The morning prayer, you begin with thanksgiving for protection during the night, and then you pray for protection from the devil and all evil during the day. Notice Luther assumes that we are in spiritual warfare, and every day we are into the battle, and we need God's protection in the battle. And not just for we pray for protection, but we pray for protection so that everything we do, all our work, is pleasing to God. Your work's pleasing to God if it comes out of prayer. And if you can get the devil out of your work, then of course your work's going to be pleasing to God. Secondly, there's a commendation taken from Psalm 31 and Jesus' words on the cross of our body and soul and all belongings. We entrust that to God. Now that's stupendous, because one of the problems that we have, we think that we have to be our own gods, taking care of our own bodies, our own souls, our own belongings. But at the beginning and end of the day, we hand everything over to God. Our bodies, our souls, our belongings, all the people we love. Put in God's hands. He knows what to do. And lastly, most remarkably, there's a petition for a guardian angel as a spiritual escort and a bodyguard every day. Lovely, lovely little prayer. And we need it more than anything else now that the battle's getting on. Let your holy angel be with me so that the evil one may have no power over me. Now, in Latin, power over me, Luther uses the word jus, which means makes no legal demands on me, doesn't use the law against me. The evening is basically the same, except for the beginning. So instead of thanking God for the protection during the night and asking for protection during the day, it begins with a thanksgiving for protection during the day, but for forgiveness of sins and protection during the night. So at the end of every day, you ask for forgiveness. Why? So that you can go to bed with a good conscience. So that you don't take your sins with you to bed. And by taking your sins with you to bed, you sleep with the devil. Then he says, okay, if you like, you can add a hymn and any other devotional exercise. Notice here that he doesn't refer to any Bible reading. He gives us a basic framework. He doesn't mention Bible reading because in those days Bibles were far too expensive for ordinary people to own. These days, if he was drawing this up now, he'd probably add a Bible reading. What's important here is that daily devotion comes before a point of transition every morning and evening. You have your daily devotion before you go to bed so that you can work with joy. And you have it before you go to sleep so you can go to sleep quickly. You're not restless and unsettled. You finish the day's business and you can go to sleep joyfully. I love that emphasis on joy. What's the secret of enjoyment? Morning and evening prayer, Luther says. Well, what's the purpose of this morning and evening blessing? Very quickly, I think you can work it out, the details out yourself. Number one, by means of this morning and evening blessing, we rise with Christ and we die with Christ. And so our day, every day is a resurrection day. We anticipate the resurrection. Every evening we have a little death in preparation of our big death, which comes at the end of time. It's a practice, an exercise of daily rising and daily dying together with Christ. Secondly, by means of daily devotion, we receive, enjoy, and we transmit God's blessings. Thirdly, by means of daily devotion, we protect ourselves, we arm ourselves for the spiritual battle, the battle against the evil one. Fourthly, by means of daily devotion, we maintain and preserve a good conscience before God, but also before each other in the family. Number five, I think it is, and this is the part that I think needs re-emphasis again, is that by means of daily devotion, day and night, work and rest, body and life, the whole family, the whole household, everything is made holy, sanctified by the Word of God, the Holy Name, and prayer. And that means that we serve as holy priests in Christ's holy priesthood within the holy order of the family. So this is priestly living. If you don't do that, well, you're still a priest, but you're a priest basically who's off duty rather than on duty. We confess our faith before others in word and deeds, and that confession of faith is our proclamation of God's grace and blessing to others. But most importantly, we intercede for ourselves, for our family, for the church, all Christians and all people around the world. An act of priestly intercession. Yes, I think I can get through this. Now, table blessings. Okay, so you have the two things. First of all, there's section 8, which is the morning and evening prayer, morning and evening blessing. Then you have grace before and after meals. You're familiar with this and the custom of it. I just want to draw out the theology of it. First of all, the blessing before the meal. Luther says that, once again, it's responsibility of the head of the house. Now, he phrases that very carefully. If a man is the head of the house, Now, father, grandfather, he's responsible for it. But many households don't have male heads. Who's responsible? The mother or the grandmother. Or if you get a bunch of siblings living together, who's responsible for it? The oldest male or the oldest female. So whoever is, in practical terms, the head of the house and is a Christian, now those two things, because you have some households that are not Christian, this is their basic priestly responsibility. And notice it's not individual, it's corporate. And the praying is to be done with folded hands, act of devotion, concentration. Notice the importance of bodily praying, not just verbal praying. And it falls into two parts. There's the Word of God and there's prayer. So the grace before meals begins with a confession from Psalm 147. The eyes of all look to you, O Lord, and you give them their food at the proper time. You open your hand and satisfy the desires of every living creature. Now that last part in Hebrew, that's the NIV translation, but the Hebrew actually is, you satisfy every living creature with joy or delight. And Luther then explains this word, this confession of God's grace, in the order of creation. He says, satisfy all living things with delights is enjoyment from food, and that's evidence of God's goodwill to us that is destroyed by worry and greed. They are the two spiritual curses of godly living. We're worry, we're greedy, and very often it has to do with food and all the necessities of life. To say grace, this part of grace, is to get rid of worry, to get rid of greed, by confessing our confidence in God's provision for us. Then secondly, he says that as well as part of the grace, we say the Lord's Prayer as our prayer of consecration. In Holy Communion, the Lord's Prayer comes before the words of institution, normally in our Lutheran service. It's the prayer of consecration. I don't know whether you realize. It's the prayer by, we have both the words of consecration and we have the prayer of consecration. The Lord's Prayer is the prayer for the consecration of the bread and wine. And so by using the Lord's Prayer at the beginning of the meal, we link the family meal with Holy Communion and Holy Communion with the family meal. And that is made more obvious for us in our Lutheran tradition with our common grace before the meal when we say, come Lord Jesus, be our guest, and let this food to us be blessed. Come, Lord Jesus, was in the early church and New Testament the Eucharistic prayer. And it's back there in some of your orders of service. So you have a verse of Scripture, a confession of faith and God's provision. You have the Lord's Prayer, and then you have the prayer of blessing. Bless us, O Lord, and these your gifts which we receive from your bountiful goodness through Jesus Christ our Lord. At least that's my form. I don't know if I've got the one that you're familiar with. And by doing that, so we pray for the blessing of both people and food by God, who is the host of the meal. We acknowledge God's the host, and he gives us this food to share his blessing with us. And then you get the thanksgiving after the meal. So you've grace before meals, because we acknowledge that everything that we have comes to us by the grace of God. After the meal, when we're satisfied, we give thanks for the meal. That's just good manners. Let's say I come to your place for dinner. You put on a slap up do for me, best wine, best food. The proper thing for me to do is to go to the woman who's prepared the meal and to say, thank you, that was a lovely meal. I really enjoyed it. Well, it's the same too with God. We've had a good meal. He satisfied us. It's not just that he's given us food. He's been there with us. we've enjoyed not just the company of the people, we've enjoyed God's company, and so we say thank you to the host of the meal for the meal that he's provided for us. Okay, now Luther recommends three things then at the end of the meal. First of all, there's the call to thanksgiving. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endures forever. Or his love endures forever. That's from Psalm 107. That's the call to thanksgiving. We call to each other, let's join in thanking God. Why? Because he's good. And it's not just that he's given us food, but his love, his mercy, his grace is forever. And then there's the second word of praise from Psalm 147. You know it well. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. He gives food to every creature. He provides food for the cattle and for the young ravens when they call. His pleasure, his delight, is not in the strength of a horse, nor his delight in the legs of a man, let alone the legs of a woman. The Lord delights those who fear him, who put their hope in his unfailing love. So, call to thanksgiving, and then the reason for thanksgiving. This is God gives us this. Then we have the Lord's Prayer again, and then we have the prayer of thanksgiving to God the Father for all his benefits. Okay, now, what's the purpose of the blessing before the meal? What's the purpose of the thanksgiving after the meal? Simple piety, simple customs, but I put it to you, it's the basic way in which the faith is passed on from generation to generation. Get rid of this and you're going uphill. Get rid of this and you haven't the foundation for instruction, let alone Christian life and Christian service. Okay, what's the purpose of this? Number one, we bless God, we acknowledge God as the giver of blessing, as the host of the meal, who gives us this food and who gives us his life-giving blessing, to us and all people through the food that he provides. The food doesn't come to us from ourselves or other people, it comes to us from God. And it's God's way by which he keeps us alive, he maintains the life, not just of Christians, but all living creatures on earth. Secondly, by means of prayer and before and after the meal, we consecrate both the food and the household with the word of God and prayer. This is an act of sanctification, not just the food, but also the family and the meal. And this is very profound if you have people who are not Christians, members of the family are not Christians. You do it on their behalf vicariously. They can't thank God, you thank God for them. They are not holy, they can't pray to God for their sanctification, but you can do it for them. Don't underestimate the impact of simple family devotions on people who are not Christians. If I had time, I'd tell you a few stories about my own family experience. And my wife's great gift is hospitality. So we have a practice of an open house every Sunday. Any members of the family who are available can at any notice, any Sunday, come for a meal. They don't have to arrange it beforehand. We have a big enough meal there to extend that. But also, my wife is very generous in offering hospitality to other people. And our children like our family meal so much that they very often, when they were younger, before they got married, would invite their friends to come along. And many of them would be lapsed Christians or unbelievers or have no contact with the church at all. And it's quite obvious what impact just that simple act of devotion. We didn't have to preach to them. We didn't Bible bash them. We didn't someone say, look, I'm going to pray over you for your conversion. We just did grace before and after meals. Amazing, the effect of that. And how they used to like coming for the meal, because sometimes they couldn't put their hand on it, but they say, "No, there's something about your family and the way you enjoy being together and the way you do meals." Okay? The food, the household, and the visitors are consecrated by the word of God and prayer. But then also, the meal calls us to thank God. Remember, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good," is a call to thanksgiving. A call to thanksgiving, not just at the beginning, at the end of the meal, but it comes at the end of the meal, because it's to go beyond the meal. We thank God at the end of the meal. Why? Because the rest of the day is to be an act of thanksgiving to God, gratitude to God. We're not just to say thanksgiving, but we are to be thanksgivers whose whole life is Eucharist, thanksgiving to God for his blessings in the order of creation and in the order of redemption. So we are thanksgivers who thank God for all his benefits and to us, not just as we work, but also as we rest as well. Lastly, there's a wonderful Jewish tradition based on Jeremiah 36, that according to Jewish tradition, all the sacrifices, all the offerings that God has instituted in the Old Covenant will disappear when the Messiah comes. But there's only one offering, one sacrifice, that is both for this age and the age to come, and that is the offering of thanksgiving, which begins in this age and comes to its own in the age to come. That's the only offering, that's the only sacrifice that we'll be doing continually and perpetually and properly and perfectly in heaven. So, by calling to thanksgiving and by saying thanksgiving in your family, in your household, you begin to do now in time what you'll be doing forever in eternity. And that means that this meal is a foretaste of the heavenly meal. What could be more wonderful than that? You've got to eat, you've got to drink every day. And God in his grace then to help us in our Christian life ties all this very simply to the simple act of eating and drinking together as a family around the table. Has the fire gone out? My challenge to you is to keep the home fires burning in your heart, in your family, in your house, in your extended family, but most of all, in your congregation with its members. Teach it, model it, help your people to reclaim this forgotten, unutilized, hidden treasure in our heritage. Why is it so important? Because this is the basic way that the church does mission. It's always done mission this way. It's the way the heritage of faith is handed on from generation to generation within the family, but also through the family. Because most of the evangelizing that's done is not done programmatically, but is done by means of family networks. In our own family, only one of our children married a Lutheran. Only one of our children married a practicing Christian. How is God doing evangelism now? We're sometimes worried because our children marry non-believers, members of other denominations, all sorts of, agnostics, atheists. Maybe it's God's doing. And maybe it's God's way of doing evangelism in our day. Maybe it's God's way of doing evangelism, provided that we do what he's called us to do, which is to keep the home fire burning.